Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strawstown Rod and Gun Club.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Just Say Sports. Been a couple weeks since we've been on. Happy to be back. My name is Rob Galtier. With me, as usual, Chris Barto. Welcome, Chris.
Hello, Rob. Happy September to you.
Happy September. Start of NFL. Mm-hmm. College football now. We got a couple weeks in the full swing. Baseball with these exciting division races and wild card races. That American League, boy.
On the edge of my seat.
Edge of your seat. There's just so many in the American League with the possibility of actually making the playoffs. Was there five teams?
Yes.
Teams?
Three for two wild card, I believe.
Three for two wild cards. So yeah. We'll be on the edge of our seats watching that.
Yeah.
You know, who knows what's going to happen with that. And, of course, your Fighting Phils just refuse to go away because they're a team of destiny. Destiny.
And character.
Character.
And hustle.
When you play hard, good things happen. And that's what's happening in Philadelphia. Let's start off NFL. Started. Mm-hmm. My team, my Eagles, gets your Redskins. Tale of two halves. Just general thoughts.
Well, I'm trying to think back to our predictions. I know I said 20-13, and you predicted a higher score, and I think we were both pretty much on the money as far as what we predicted spread-wise. And, of course, the cover for the Redskins was a backdoor total at the end of the game, meaningless score at that. But some of my thoughts from the Redskins' point of view were that the Jonathan Allen injury hurt them badly. He had been playing well, and the whole defensive line shifted around, and they became weaker, and really overall during the whole game didn't get enough pressure on Carson Wentz, I thought. The missed bomb to McLaurin, the rookie, in the second half.
That was the killer.
After the Eagles had serious momentum, and he broke free again on almost the same play that he scored on in the first half. That really hurt the Redskins as well. They could have taken a lot of momentum back and gotten another big score.
What was crazy about that play was how accurate Keenum was most of the game. He missed that one by 7 yards. It wasn't like it was heavy pressure. He stood, turned, released, and just missed him.
Yeah, he's fast, but not quite that fast. I think the Eagles totally contain Ryan Kerrigan. How many times did you hear his name?
Yeah, Lane Johnson's a stud.
Yeah, he did.
If you ask me who the best Philadelphia Eagle, you know, some people would say Wentz, some people would say Fletcher Cox. Mm-hmm. I still say Lane Johnson was playing on one leg last year and was still dominant. He's healthy again. He's a terrific player.
Kerrigan was invisible. And Landon Collins really was not involved in the action that much either from the Redskins' defensive point of view.
Although, in fairness to him, he was on Zach Ertz a lot. Mm-hmm. So when you look at Ertz's overall game, it wasn't very productive, and I think a lot of that was Landon Collins.
Mm-hmm. That's an excellent point. The Redskins had no running game. They were one-dimensional. And overall, I think they pass blocked well. Keenum had enough time usually and also made some nice throws off balance and out of the pocket. But you can't be that one-dimensional and be successful over the course of 60 minutes. And that is Jay Gruden's Redskins. They're not a 60-minute team. They're a half. They're three quarters. And that's what you end up with.
Well, I thought the Redskins were super prepared. Obviously, they came out, a lot of misdirection. They had the Eagles completely baffled. Jim Schwartz is so conservative early in the game, and Gruden knew that. He wasn't going to blitz.
Mm-hmm.
They took advantage of so much. I mean, it was just consistently short, short, short. Even the Vernon Davis touchdown was a fairly short pass.
Oh, sure.
Where the Eagles just... It was interesting. I heard someone on the radio this morning called it a Sean Considine moment.
Mm.
Former Eagles safety who was just always stumbling all over himself. Yeah. And Sendejo had one of those moments. But the Redskins were prepared for that game. And I know Doug Peterson, he's talking about getting off to a great start, great start, great start. Well, when your offense cannot get onto the field, I mean, that's... And it's worked out well because Peterson stays away from the defense. That's Jim Schwartz's. But if you want to get off to fast starts, I think with this defensive team, they need to be more aggressive from the beginning.
Yeah, I would agree because the total yardage and time of possession was drastically the Redskins' advantage in the first half.
No question.
And you saw how it played out. They dominated on the scoreboard and on the stat sheet. And once the Eagles started to figure it out and get some three and outs, then it was ball game, basically.
It was ball game. Yeah. And Gruden was trying to force the run. And you can't blame him for trying because you just see the Eagles pounding and pounding and pounding. And he knows he can't go three passes and out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the NFL, you have to establish a run game at some point, and really the Eagles never allowed the Redskins to do that.
There's controversy around Adrian Peterson not suiting up a healthy scratch the first time in his career. Doesn't make any sense to me as a Redskins fan, and certainly has caused waves in the locker room. So that'll be interesting to see. But now Darius Geis's other knee is hurt, so no reason Peterson won't be playing going forward. The thing that did make me happy was that they finally moved on from Josh Doctson, the majorly failed first-round pick from 4 years ago. And the young receivers played extremely well, I thought, for Washington.
They did very well. I liked a lot of the young talent that the Redskins have. I think there's a lot to work with there. Overall, it's just that they weren't able to maintain the momentum. And again, Case Keenum hits that pass. Redskins go back up 13. Completely different ball game.
Mm-hmm.
Because do you remember the play right after he missed him? Keenum threw a 15-yard out right in the hands of the Redskins receiver. I forget who it was, and it was dropped.
Mm.
So momentum really just shut down for the Redskins. And by that point, once the Eagles took the lead,
I think it might have been Vernon Davis.
Yeah, it just snowballed on them, and the Eagles took it away. Just Say Sports is the program. Phone number to call in is 610-378-0426. If you want to join in the discussion, talking NFL, Major League Baseball, college football, anything you want to join in with. We have a phone call right now. Hello, caller, and welcome to the program.
Hello.
Hello.
I'd just like to talk about the Eagles a little bit. I've been looking for information on the Eagles on ESPN last night and all today, and the Eagles aren't mentioned once on ESPN. I don't know if you guys have any insight into it, or could it have something to do with the magazine and their pictures, but it's going to come out sooner or later, so there's not a word about the Eagles on any ESPN show.
Well, I don't think there was anything yesterday outside of maybe DeSean Jackson's return to Philadelphia that was really newsworthy. I mean, that was really Patriots and the Chiefs day yesterday.
Good point about DeSean.
No, that's not it. There's going to be something coming out about it because you don't omit an NFL game that has been played on a Sunday. ESPN just doesn't do that. There's something behind it. That's all. I just wondered if you knew anything. Thank you.
No, I'd be interesting.
I'm not aware of anything happening.
No,
just... Right.
Yep. Thanks for the phone call.
Thank you.
Take care.
Good night.
Yeah, not sure. I didn't watch ESPN after the Eagles game yesterday. So
I didn't either. I ended up falling asleep in the middle of that Patriots Steelers affair.
What exactly happened?
Nothing good for the Steelers. It was pure domination by New England. Had receivers running open, running the ball. Tom Brady all day to throw. So, yeah. New England looked pretty good.
Are we looking at a downturn? Let's face it, the Patriots are the defending Super Bowl champ. I thought there might be a little bit of, not chaos, but the whole Antonio Brown. I thought there might be a lack of focus, but apparently not, because that was just a beat down from start to finish.
Total drubbing, yeah.
But you got to at some point you got to look at, do the Steelers have the talent? I don't want to make the same comparison, but when LeSean McCoy and DeSean Jackson, who were probably the Eagles' two best offensive players, a wide receiver and a running back, were sent away from Chip Kelly, it was no surprise that Chip Kelly's teams went into the toilet not long after.
Yeah, James Conner's a good back, but did they have a good enough line to make holes for him and protect Roethlisberger? I think that's yet to be seen. Juju Smith's a good receiver. He was double covered, I think, mm-hmm. so non-factor.
Well, and that's the thing. Juju was living on Antonio Brown getting most of the mm-hmm. the coverage. When you lose star players, everything shifts. You said it. You already said it. This program, you know, mm-hmm. the Redskins had to shift their entire line after the injury.
Yep. Yeah, it makes a difference. Your 53-man roster, you just are not that deep at every position, and injuries hurt.
Yep. And that's where I think in the long run, outside of quarterback, where I'm not sold on Josh McCown, I think Howie Roseman did his best job mm-hmm. of creating depth throughout that roster. And I think you could see it when the Eagles had their cuts. A lot of those guys were snapped up right away. Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't be able to tell from how well they played in the preseason, but there were some individual players that have NFL ability and just weren't able to make the Eagles roster this year. So,
yeah, I would sum up yesterday, the better team won. That's how I look at it.
I think at this point in the season, with the experience and so forth, there's no doubt. And I think Cowboys looked really good yesterday.
They did.
I'm now officially, yes, Dak Prescott is good. I'm okay to say that. As an Eagles fan, I'm okay to say that. He just had that long stretch where he was awful.
Mm-hmm.
But he really turned it on second half of last year and came out very confident.
Yeah, having Jason Witten back in the fold, whether he's a big part of the offense or not, just has to help his confidence, I think.
Yeah. So after yesterday's day, anybody do you see in the AFC that can compete with New England and Kansas City?
Tell you what, it certainly wasn't the Browns.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. But look at Baltimore. And, you know, we had our fantasy draft, and I wanted Lamar Jackson. He went the round before I could get him.
Yeah.
I just had a feeling that he's ready to have a phenomenal statistical year if he's healthy. And, wow, sure, they beat the worst team, it looks like, by far in the league. But
it was basically Alabama, New Mexico State.
Yeah.
I mean, so I don't know how much to take from it. Now, I thought they looked good in the preseason, mm-hmm. but he plays his starters a lot in the preseason, and that's another thing. They were ready to play.
Absolutely.
From the first minute on.
And I think they have a bit of a chip on their shoulder, especially Lamar Jackson. I saw some comments on Twitter. Yeah, not bad for a running back.
Yeah.
So he knows. The doubters and the haters are out there, and he has the ability to prove them wrong. And, boy, they showed some talent, speed, and that you don't expect from Baltimore.
Well, he was the most dominant player in college football for 2 years. And
yes.
He did it. People forget how good of a thrower he was. He was throwing for 300-plus yards every game. It's just when you're running for 170 as mm-hmm. well.
Yes.
I mean, he was a one-man show, a terrific player. And there's a reason why Joe Flacco is
In Denver.
In Denver now.
Yes.
Yeah, because of that.
Mm-hmm.
Let's flip the script a little bit, move on to our favorite baseball team.
Okay.
Philadelphia. Ken Rosenthal with an article in The Athletic basically ripping the Phillies. Phillies, the management, the manager. This is a frustrating team beyond belief.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that the Phillies even had a guy named Nick Vincent?
Did not.
I just happened to look at the pickups at the September 1 deadline, and mm-hmm. you know, they bring up all these guys, and I follow Lehigh Valley, I follow Reading, I follow the Phillies minor league system, And then all of a sudden, Nick Vincent was in that list. So I had to look him up, and he's a journeyman who stunk everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow, I don't know how it's possible when you have September 1 call-ups, when you have 37 pitchers on your roster, the two most critical games to keep the Phillies alive in the wild card came down to a guy named Nick Vincent, who's never had success in his life.
And he looked scared to death.
Oh, my God, as he looked. And Gabe Kapler's excuse, as I'm driving for the Friday night loss, as I'm driving Saturday morning and I hear this, and I almost drove off the road, you know, because he's trying to work the margins, He thought that his sinker ball would create weak contact. So that's what he was going with. You know, the same sinker baller who gave up a home run the night before to lose a game.
And his ball four was a foot high.
Wow. I mean, the fact that this guy has a job is just mind-blowing to me. And now I'm completely convinced Matt Klentak won't fire him only because he knows he's next on the chopping block. John Middleton's going to have to be the one that say Kapler goes. If Kapler comes back, you'll have no enthusiasm for baseball next year in Philadelphia.
No, and the thought this afternoon, among others, that I had is that Kapler just has no instincts whatsoever on how to create a lineup, how to manage a lineup, or a game. He got lucky once or twice because Logan Morrison hit a pinch hit home run. He just happened to send up the guy that could do that at one point. But 99 times out of 100, he has no idea.
Well, he painted himself in a corner in the one Reds game where he used Morrison and Jay Bruce back to back. Adam Haseley had two doubles in the game and he pinch hit for him. Ended up having Hector Neris leading off the next inning. Mm-hmm. And then he ran out of relievers. Again.
Yeah.
Now, granted, his relievers, and this is Klentak, and this is the philosophy of and this is where Ken Rosenthal, in his article, talked about all the Braves relievers they picked up and trading for signing Keuchel. Phillies were a game and a half up on the Braves when the Braves signed Dallas Keuchel.
Mm-hmm. And he's a game or two over 500, but they've been in almost all of his starts.
He gives them a great start. He's basically Vargas, but he'll give you that sixth inning, which Vargas cannot give you. Mm-hmm. And that keeps coming back to bite the Phillies, because if you make this team pitch four innings out of this bullpen.
And some of those Braves pickups are now getting saves for him.
Yeah.
Routinely.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, they've got a terrific bullpen. Big series, though, big series. How do you think the Phillies are going to do against the Braves in this series?
How many games is it? Four?
I believe so, yeah.
If they go 2-2, that will be amazing.
Well, you know what? I'd take 2-2 right now, but they have to go 3-1 if they have any shot of making the playoffs.
And it starts with Aaron Nola tonight.
And Nola has been a huge disappointment, because two times in a row the Phillies have gotten momentum, and two times in a row he has not pitched well. And this is against Miami and Cincinnati.
And we've been proven right. They will not get to that 5-game winning streak this season.
No, no. Heck, I say they need a 10-game winning streak to have a chance to make the playoffs. I mean, how's that even going to be possible?
If they go 2-2, they need to have a 4-2 week. And I just don't see it.
No, no. Especially with the schedule they have. Braves, Indians, Red Sox, Nationals.
Yeah, before the show, I saw on my phone, they have a span of 6 games in just over 100 hours at the end of the year.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, good luck winning 5 of them.
Sets up for a great story. We'll go back to the phones. Hello and welcome to Just Say Sports.
Thank you. I'm calling from Delaware, so I have no idea what you were talking about. But I had some reflections on the NFL games.
Sure.
First of all, the biggest idiot was Odell Beckham, who wore a $350,000 watch during the game.
Yeah, I did see something about his watch.
And you wonder why people can't relate to certain athletes.
Yeah, $350,000 watch. A couple other things. I think one of the biggest disappointments was the way the Steelers got beat down by the Patriots.
Yeah, we did touch on that. And do you think this is really a downward slope for the Steelers, or are they going to somewhat right the ship like they normally do?
I wouldn't count a lot on them righting the ship, but we'll have to wait and see.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing was not living up to the overhype, the Browns.
Yeah, they were never in that game, really.
Right. And then you had the Lions blowing a 24-6 lead in the fourth quarter and ended up with a meaningless tie. Right.
Well, that's that former Patriots defensive coordinator.
Is that right?
Yeah, Matt Patricia. Yeah. It's the guy who gave up 1,000 points to the Eagles in the Super Bowl and then got a job right afterwards. Not sure what game. I guess he was already hired before the Super Bowl.
Right.
But
yeah.
You know, they get rid of him and then they hold the Rams to 3 points in the next Super Bowl. So.
About that. One of the biggest surprises, I thought, of course it didn't matter in the end, but the way the Redskins jumped out to that 17-0 lead, I guess that was because Wentz didn't play it down during the preseason.
Well, you know what, though? The Eagles never had the ball.
That's true.
It was really just, it was the Redskins just play after play after play. And then once they finally got a stop, it seemed Wentz then was able to get the ball. Yeah, so anything else?
No, I think that's enough. Just one. Oh, my wife says, how about Serena Williams losing?
Yeah, she's struggling finishing these off lately.
Yeah.
She's, what, 43 years old, 44?
I think 37, maybe.
37.
The 20th year on tour.
It's amazing that she still even cares enough to play.
Yeah. Yeah,
Venus is older than Serena. So,
yeah.
And I think she retired just recently.
Yeah. No, it's been amazing that Serena, you know, I would have loved to seen her play Osaka, but Naomi didn't quite get there this year.
Yeah.
So.
I think she needs one more major to either tie or break Margaret Court's record.
Yeah, and I just don't know if it's going to happen.
Yeah, it gets
tougher and tougher as we get further. Just ask Tiger.
Yeah.
What's up next, Australia?
Yes.
In January.
Yep. Yeah. Start all over again.
Well, she'll probably play.
Oh, she'll play. Thanks for the phone call.
You bet.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
College football, quickly, we got a minute left. Penn State, really poor first half, really great second half.
Yeah, not much to add to that. That's about the way the game played out. Pitt this week, 17-point favorites, will be interesting.
Clemson, might as well pencil them in already, the championship game. They don't play a game. The best team they play now is North Carolina the rest of the year.
Yeah, and Mack Brown isn't quite there yet.
No, he's not quite where Dabo is. Quickly, you got a play for this week?
Yeah.
For entertainment purposes only.
My best bet would be Oklahoma -22 over UCLA, who has scored 14 points in each of their first two games.
Yeah, but Chip Kelly's an offensive genius, so don't forget about that.
How about you?
Guy's a big game coach. You know what? I'm going to go with Iowa State at home, -1.5 versus Iowa. Iowa's played Miami of Ohio, Rutgers, blown them both out. Two of the worst teams in college football. I think it's going to be a down year, and Iowa State's going to jump all over them early. So, thank you very much for watching the program. We'll be back in a couple weeks for Just Say Sports. For Chris Barto, I'm Rob Galtier. Thank you so much.
Just Say Sports on BCTV is supported by Strosstown Rod and Gun Club.